Hi, I'm your host, Tom DeSavia. Join me as I interview guests from music and entertainment from around the world about what they're up to right now. Stay tuned, because we're gone in 30 minutes.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Gone in 30 Minutes. Very, very happy. I think it's our 10th guest. I believe you're our 10th guest, Matt.
Wow.
Our guest today is Matt Berninger. Welcome. Welcome, my friend. Welcome to the podcast. Do people try to throw a hard G in your name all the time?
They do. I mean, it's even family members often have. It's often been debated how my last name is pronounced. Berninger is. We answered everything.
So, what are you up to right now, buddy? What's going on?
Drinking coffee in my garage cave office, which is behind my brother's house, which is a few blocks from where I live. And yeah, I'm coming here. I've been attempting to do nothing as much as possible lately. Just come and sit, not even turn on the stereo, and see what happens. So I've literally been putting a lot of effort into doing nothing. It's not easy just to sit there. It's my version of meditating, just like sitting in a chair.
Doing nothing but being in your creative space
as opposed to. Yeah, doing nothing. You know, it's like there's a lot that can happen when you sit there and just waste an hour, you know, just like stare out the window.
Does it wind up turning into something? Does your nothing end in something?
It's turning into something eventually, because your clock slows down. You know, you can just like, you know, I will not pretend that it is a form of meditation at all, because I can't even get close to meditating. I've tried to meditate so many times. I can't, or at least maybe I can. It just, I don't never have confidence that I actually am. Anyway, yeah, but no, it's nice to have a spot. And I do most of my writing like here. I do so much, or just most of my processing, you know, here. I like having an office. I think it's when I quit my sort of corporate job, that was something I really missed. I like going to a place, I like going to an office, going to a room, and, you know, and sharpening the pencils and thinking, okay, here we go. I don't necessarily write well in the office, but I like being in the office. It's like I do more of my writing outside the office, but sort of going to the office is some other part of the ritual.
Has our current world, our COVID world, changed your creative process at all? Like, because you're supposed to be on tour right now, like many people, right? You were supposed to be on a pretty extensive national tour, and then promoting Serpentine Prison, which just came out. Mm-hmm. And so do you find it's like it's launched you into thinking differently about your creative process, or you just like take this?
I think so. Yeah. I mean, on some levels, it's touring. I did manage after a while to start to find ways on tour to go to the office, meaning to disappear. The hotels, and just like putting on the do not disturb sign on the hotel room and just closing the curtains. I spend more time on tour probably in a hotel room with, like, you know, a candle lit and the blackout curtains than I do anywhere else on tour, you know. And a lot of it is I just have to recharge. I have to rest, and like doing the shows and the travel is incredible. It's and exhausting and exciting. And then if you try to add partying on top of that, then you can only do that for like a week, and you're ruined. That's why bands don't last very long. So I don't really party much. I party on stage. I party right before, you know, we get on stage, but I really go back in. So when I'm in my hotel room, I am able to kind of get into that, you know, sort of just slow, weird, gooey creative brain space, especially because of the jet lag. And so in a lot of ways, touring can actually be a creative place after a while, if you figure out how to do that. You know, you turn your hotel room into a weird, dark mental, you know, exploratory space, you know, like, and that works. I found touring much healthier once I like learned how to like kind of make the hotel room mine every time, you know. Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally. Well, and it's funny, I wonder if you, because I was talking to someone about this the other day, where, you know, by my job, which I've been doing since I was 19, my job is essentially to be an extrovert. That's just the job. You're meeting with people all the time, you're interacting with people all the time in an office environment or in a social environment.
Yeah.
But I've always said, like, I always need at least, like, if I could go like 3-4 days, and then when I run out the battery, it just stops.
Mm-hmm.
It stops, and I need alone time to sort of recharge. Yeah. And I've sort of read this, and X sent me something once about the extroverted introvert, or the introverted extrovert, I forget which way it was. And, yeah, and I read and I checked off every box. I'm like, oh shit, that's what I am. You know, I'm this. Yeah. So I found to be able to take that time. And now it's sort of the opposite. Now I'm looking for things like this to sort of engage me. And it's, you know, I mean, have you, because same thing, you probably haven't been home this long in how long? 15 years? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it is a funny thing. Everyone's social behaviors are so flipped or just, I mean, and, yeah, I get that. I've so much of my life is about being an extrovert, you know, whether it's on stage or whether it's in interviews, you know, or whether it's just backstage and on tour and in you know, everywhere, when you're around people, so many people all the time, and your, you know, obligation is to go to so many sort of get-togethers, and not obligation, but just these things you can't say no to, and you're forced to be. I've had to learn to be a more social person, or learn how to figure out how to enjoy that if I can more than I think it, you know, is natural for a person to enjoy. You know, I think most people actually struggle at parties and struggle at social events, and I do. Whereas like a rock show is perfect because it's not that social. I mean, it's social. You get to be around all these people. It's also like church, where you don't do a lot of talking. You're not supposed to like mingle that much. You're supposed to be there together in a thing, experiencing something together. And I like those kind of social things, you know?
Well, it's funny, going back to what you were saying earlier. So you were an office hack for a long time. You had a day job. You went to work, like, so that had to add some weird discipline to your life that then you were able to unshackle. Did a lot of that discipline stick with you? Do you think that, like, that structure, I should say? I don't know if discipline's the right word.
Yeah, or the, I think discipline, I mean, it's sort of the right word. I think the professionalism or something like that. Yeah. Meaning, going, like, getting a job and kind of rising the ranks. I moved to New York and became a junior designer at a new media company, just right as people were starting to have websites. You know, it was just shortly after email, people started using email. And so like 90, late 90s. And I went from junior designer to creative director in probably about 5 or 6 years. And having clients and lots of different types of clients, you know, like cool, like clients that were like, you know, the Metropolitan Museum of Art. But then there's a thing called the Thomas Register, which is like an encyclopedia, like of machine parts, like all like the smallest, you know, every kind of machine part. If you're building for engineers building machines, it was how to find all the parts to build machines. And it was like these huge, you know, it would take up a wall in a mechanics office or a machinist or, you know, room, these encyclopedias. And I had to figure out, take all that and make a website for that. And that was like, that was exciting. That was really fun. And having all these different corporate clients and pharmaceutical clients and financial industry clients, and, you know, learning all the sectors and stuff, and having working with a big team of really interesting professional people, and, you know, high stress turnarounds and, you know, all nighters all the time. And that was, and then hiring a team of people. And then later, you know, with the bubble burst and having to lay off people, having to go through all that side of what it is to be a business. Yeah. All of that very much informed all my writing. I think towards the beginning, you hear me writing so much about feeling a business, like a business person trapped in or something, you know, inside of a, but that continues now. I genuinely value all of that experience. You know, I think the National is still a band. A lot of it is because we all maybe sort of went through some sort of, phases of learning about just friendship, art, and trying to make smart business choices, you know, yeah. From the beginning. Aaron's like that too, you know, and everybody in the band, I think a lot of our experience, of being in New York and all having kind of whatever serious jobs did ultimately really, help the National navigate a lot of, things.
What were you like as a kid?
I mean, I had a huge ego. I was mostly like a goofy kid. I think I got away with a lot of shit because of sense of humor, but I was a nice kid. I was always, you know, I would always be asked to all the dances because I was nice and could dance pretty good. And like my older sister's friends would always ask me to their high school dances and stuff like that. I was like medium popular, you know. I wasn't that athletic, but I was somewhere in the sort of like a foot in both the nerd, artsy nerd and whatever tough guy world. I don't know. I was kind of like, yeah.
Was music invading your life like from a young age? Like, well, when did, cause I know about your art background, but when did music sort of come?
It's funny. Like being in love with music and hit music around the house, like as a kid, I always think of, I've talked about this a lot, but you know, my parents didn't have a big record collection, but the 20 or so records they had were just like all I really remember until I was 13 or 14. Right. So before I was 13 or 14, it was, you know, some country, Willie Nelson, Roberta Flack, some R&B, you know, Olivia Newton-John stuff and Judy Collins and, you know, just kind of a kind of weird spectrum of stuff, but not a big collection of music.
One of those 20 records your pop had was Stardust by Willie Nelson. And that was something you'd been listening to or just had heard. It was in the air growing up, right? That was one of the major records.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I didn't realize till we were talking that that record was produced by Booker T.
Right.
I've known that record for years. And so that had to inform your makeup so much, just hearing that record so much. And I'm coming back around because obviously you made this new record and you have a partnership with Booker T now. How did that come about, you two getting together?
You know, it's a very circuitous way is that about 12 years ago, Booker, I was asked to sing do a duet with Sharon Jones on a record that Booker T was doing. And back then I didn't even know that he had produced and arranged Stardust, right? That wasn't in my head. All I knew is that, wait, Booker T. Jones. And at first I was like, wait, you're talking about the Booker T. Jones wants me? And so I went and did that. And that was just this incredible experience. And I got to meet him and I met all these really incredible people, including Sharon Jones, the late Sharon Jones, no relation. And I just really, really just, that was just one of these amazing experiences that I almost just like, well, that happened, and put it away like in this, like someday I'll tell that story. Like, cause it was only a few hours that I was in the studio with him. And so and we did not keep in touch for 10 years, Booker and I. But about 2 years ago, I was cooking up the idea of doing a covers album, and a local record store here, I went, was buying a bunch of vinyl that I, and they had Stardust. I was like, oh, Stardust, like, you know, my, one of my dad's favorite records. And I took it home and I flipped it over, and right on the top, I should pull it out. But right on the top, it says produced and arranged in all caps by Booker T. Jones. And that was one of these, like, that was really like, this record was produced by Booker. And I met him once, and maybe I could get him to play on something someday. And cause I want to make a record that's kind of like this. And, yeah. And that was, and so I went to his website and clicked on the button, for management, and his daughter Olivia wrote me back the next day. And you know, luckily they remembered who I was from 10 years earlier, and he was interested, and it developed into this whole sort of relationship where we were working on a lot of covers, and then I started sharing some originals with him, and this record turned into more originals than covers. But I hadn't been thinking about this for like a long time. It kind of, the idea came up of a covers record, and then this like lucky connection I made, and I reached out and made it work, and he was incredible. It was such a the whole thing, I feel like, was almost like a dream, you know.
It's amazing when you go down the Booker T sort of rabbit hole and realize just how much of pop culture is touched. And it's at like those moments, like, I didn't know till we were having that conversation. I knew the Stardust record really well. I didn't know he produced it until you brought that up.
Yeah. And you don't know, there's so many things that he's on that he's all over the place, and you don't realize it. And you know, he's very much the Zelig like character in contemporary American music, you know, like everything, disco and country and soul and everything, you know. And so it's, I actually did not bring in Booker for any aesthetic. I mean, yes, Stardust, he produced and arranged it, and I wanted the record to have that kind of a atmosphere and that kind of a sort of feeling to it. But it wasn't so much that I wanted Booker to bring in all these different genres, you know, with him. It was, I kind of wanted his personality. And because I remember in the studio, you know, a decade earlier, it was a chaotic situation. A lot of people were coming and going. It was kind of, you know, and not a lot of time. It was on a schedule, and through in the middle of that, Booker was just so pleasant, you know, and made it so. I mean, I remember being really worked up and nervous, and you know, and he was just so pleasant. So I was like, well, I wonder what would happen if I spent 2.5 weeks with him, you know, instead of 2.5 hours. And all I can say, it was incredibly pleasant the whole time. It was, he brought that thing, that this sort of like, making the room fun, making the room feel serious, making the room feel like we're here to do something important, you know. And he brought all that, and all the musical stuff too.
Well, you know? You just said, and that's what I mean, I was sort of getting around to, because he does one of the things like that, as there's, you know, really, you know, there's many types of producers, and there's certainly, you know, the producers you bring in that you're going to get their sound. You're going to get like, okay, I want that. I want the Daniel Lanois guitar sound. I want the, you know, whoever drum sound. I want the thing. The thing that I went down this rabbit hole a while ago, because I knew those MG records really well, but I didn't know like a lot of what he'd done. And I literally started at Wikipedia and went through. And what's fascinating about him, I think specifically about when it comes to Serpentine Prison, is he's such a chameleon that he doesn't enforce a sound on anything he does that I hear. I guess if someone wants a Booker T vibe, he could sit there and deliver that, but he really kind of comes in and it seems like, you know, it's a wholly new sound you two created.
Yeah, with Booker, it's almost like there's a I don't know, there's a special sort of vibe, or there's a temperature, there's a spirit in the room on songs that he's on. And you won't know is necessarily Booker T. Like there's some songs have like just a spirit to them. And I mean, is it the way he's playing the Hammond? Is it because he does it so subtly and you don't hardly knows? He only steps into the spotlight when you're so moved by the song you don't even realize you're listening to a Hammond solo, right?
Right.
So he knows that he's always there servicing something else, right? And so I think that's why he's an incredible musician, he's an incredible producer, is because when he's listening back, he's not listening for individuals, he's not listening for so specifically himself at all, he's listening for an experience, right? And he'll know exactly what these ingredients. I mean, he's just a chef. He's a master chef. Where he like you know, he takes a sip of soup, and he knows exactly what to take out and what to add. You know,
right.
So that's what it was like all the time. Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's well, and like I said, just getting to know you during all this, you seem to be someone who's really a collaborator. You really enjoy collaboration.
Yeah, I can't do anything. I can't really make anything alone. Even, I mean, I would never be able to sit down and like write a novel. Or I would never, like, even doing, you know, art painting and artwork like that. I do it, but like, I don't, it's like, it's more fun to do it in a studio with a bunch of people, you know, where there's like a bunch of people making art. Like I like art camp. That's why I do love being in a band. I love going in the studio, and I love being in a design studio and all that stuff. I do like being on a team of creative people trying to solve a problem together. You know, it's like West Wing or something, or Apollo 13. I love that vibe, you know. And all right, time to make a record, you know, or go on tour, and you rally you get everybody together. So, I can't really make stuff.
Yeah, no,
I make stuff alone, but it's lonely.
Well, I was gonna say, and was it? It had to be a, you know, an adjustment just going into a solo creation, and you seem to put together the right staff for it. Was it fun? Would it make you enjoy it more when you were around another group of people?
It made me, one big thing is it made me realize just how fun it is to make music with anybody, and how fun it is to be in a room with people. And I think what the problem is sometimes with rock bands, and I'll say this with the National, like we've been in the room, so many rooms together, so many small rooms all over the world, shows, backstages for so long. And you just start to breathe the same oxygen and that's why I think the National is still an interesting and good and healthy band, because everybody is able to like get out of that room sometimes and go into some other rooms and realize like, oh, remember why you go into rooms with people. It's about what you're doing together, not what's going on with you individually, you know. When you join another gang for a while, it reminds you you spend time with another family, right. You know, you really start to learn about your own family and put your own family in perspective, you know?
Yeah. Right on. Okay. You know what it's time for, Matt?
Is it time for the lightning? The lightning hat?
Tell me if this is the truth.
Is that Sammy Davis's Jr. his actual hat?
That is actual hat. I actually have a certificate of authenticity I could send you if you don't believe me. And I wish you'd.
I'd like you to
so aggressive and challenge like me.
Get over right away, that certificate.
I got another room. I swear to God. No, it was a friend of mine went and bought it at an estate sale. It's an Abercrombie and Fitch.
That is cool. Hat. That is a Rat Pack hat.
That's a Rat Pack hat. Maybe I'll let you borrow it.
Okay.
But just borrow it. You can't have it.
I've got a really douchey Rat Pack hat. I'll put on for my for the end.
Okay, I'll do it to it, you know.
Here's my
I took my questions out of the hat, and I'll just wear this.
I did go through a phase of thinking that if I got just the right hat, I would.
This was all a setup to just make me look idiotic in a hat, isn't it? Look how cool you look in that hat.
No, I look like a jackass.
I look like a jackass. I look like I'm
look like jackasses. Anyway.
Good. All right. Well, I took the questions out, so I'm just going to ask the questions. You can pass on any of these, but I might judge you if you pass. I always like to start with, what was your first celebrity crush? Go for it.
Olivia Newton-John.
Good one. What's the best single day on the calendar for you?
The best single day?
Yes.
Ooh, I like Christmas Day. It's also my dad's birthday. I love Christmas. Nice. I mean, it's always a stressful day. I like the day. I like the 26th. That's the best, right?
That's my favorite day. The longest time until Christmas again.
Yeah, and then it's like all the family shit's over, but you don't have to go back to school, and you can just like you can do whatever the fuck you want on the 26th. You know, I like that one the best.
Our producer just pointed out to me that it's the 11th show, not our 10th. We specifically find that 11 is a good number and a very lucky number. Can we go with that? So you're the 11th guest.
I'm okay with that.
What's the first tune you learned to play?
I can't play any tunes.
Can you not play anything?
Actually, no. I took piano lessons. No, I took piano lessons and, you know, did all that stuff. What's the ten 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 or whatever that one? Florida Loon or whatever. I don't know what it is. And so, but I got really stressed out learning a piano in a recital, and I think I turned away from that. And so I can't really, I really don't play any instruments. So I mean, I can toot away on a harmonica as long as it doesn't have to be in key with anything.
Do you ever do that, like outside, lonely, one tear rolling down your face, and just play something emotional?
I do that.
I want to see you do that wearing this hat.
I do that. I ride my bike with no hands and just playing the harmonica with tears coming down. That's how I met my wife.
We get matching teardrop tattoos. What musician do you wish the world knew more about?
Eric Bachman of Arches of Loaf and Crooked Fingers. Yeah, I think I think a lot of people do know about him, but Eric Bachman is a songwriter I just think is, I just love the way he writes songs.
Who else do you love? What other songwriters? Who are your favorites? New or old?
Well, I do. I mean, I think right now there are more. I actually think they're better songwriters right now than there have been in a long time. I think a lot of people, like I've talked a lot about Phoebe Bridgers. I think she's one of the best writers. I think Fiona Apple's writing incredibly powerful stuff. I think Nick Cave is actually even writing some of his most powerful stuff. And Leonard Cohen's last record was his most powerful, or like one of his most powerful records. So I actually... Black Star, you know, by David Bowie. I think we are in phases of high art, really good music, really good rock and roll. Christian Lee Hudson is a really great songwriter. I've been working with so many really amazing new people that and just with touring with the National, just so many, This Is the Kit and Eve Owen I've met so many, Adia Victoria. We've had so many incredible people open for us that I think the bar is much higher in terms of songwriting than it was 10 years ago or when I started.
What mystery do you wish you knew the answer to?
Well, I really genuinely would love for a higher intelligence to present itself and save our asses. So I really long. I don't need or desire the existence of an interventionist God at all. Just give us cooler hats from the future.
It's all we want. It's all we want. Seriously, man, your record has been a really, I'm going to use the I word, but important record to me during lockdown. It's great to get to know you. And
important, not impotent.
Impotent.
Got it.
It's impotent. But that's why I'm thinking a better hat might help me out.
Thank you. I'm glad it's helping you. I'm glad it's working. Yeah, that's great. That's great.
We're just getting warmed up and we got to go.
Yeah, I know. We're just starting to get inappropriate. That's great. This was fun. Thank you, Tom.
It was fun. Thank you for being here. Thank you, everybody. And we'll see you next time on the show. Gone in 30 minutes. The logo's right there. There he is.
There. I don't know if we're in post-production mode, but here it is.
There it is. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Matt.
All right, you guys. Thanks, Tom. Bye.
Bye.
This show is presented by Craft Recordings. Thanks for joining us for Gone in 30 Minutes. Produced by Laura Saez. I'm your host, Tom, and we'll catch you next time.